This video is sponsored by Span. Every major car company is struggling to build electric vehicles fast enough, and for good reason. They're really quick and fun to drive, require almost zero maintenance, and are way cheaper to charge than gasoline. But there's another benefit. The entire process is reversible. Use energy from the pack to drive your car, then turn around and plug it in and charge it back up. This just wasn't true for gasoline, but EVs are really expensive, and odds are you already have an internal combustion car. So what if there was a new breakthrough that could change all that and let you keep driving your gas car in a renewable way? We're talking about e-fuels. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. The internal combustion engine, or ICE, is regarded as the main culprit behind the climate crisis. This is why it's on most countries' agendas to phase out ICE-powered vehicles by 2050 or sooner. As you know, I'm a big advocate for EVs, and I believe they're the future of mobility. But you have to admit, for all the bad they might be for the environment, or rather what we've done by using them, internal combustion engines have also been a key to humanity's progress. Without them, cars probably wouldn't really exist, at least not in the scale that they do today. The Wright brothers wouldn't have invented powered flight in 1903, and the international shipping industry would look a lot different without cargo ships crossing the Atlantic. The main reason why the ICE has been so successful throughout its almost 150 years of existence is that it's allowed us to harness one of the most energy-dense, easily extractable, and easily storable sources of energy, fossil fuels. But this created a big problem for the environment. By taking fossil fuels from the ground and burning them in our engines, we've released too much carbon into the atmosphere, upsetting the delicate balance that controls the Earth's climate. Now, we're faced with having to clean up our mess. Thankfully, today we have EVs, so we just ditch the old gas-hungry cars, trucks, and SUVs and get EVs instead, right? Sadly, things aren't that simple. Phasing out the internal combustion engine is more challenging than it seems. First, we may not be able to electrify everything that currently runs on internal combustion engines. EVs are a no-brainer for personal passenger vehicles, but unless we make a gigantic breakthrough in battery energy density, things like commercial aviation, air transportation, jet fighters, and the heavy shipping industry may never be able to be fully electrified. The batteries we'd need to provide the necessary range would just be too heavy. But size and weight aren't as important for applications like home energy storage. And if you're thinking about getting solar, or a home battery, or a new electric panel, or a car charger, you'll definitely want to hear about our sponsor this week. In fact, I'm installing mine as soon as I get my permits in the coming weeks. Span is the innovative company that builds this, the Span panel, the central brain of your electric home. Let me give you a few cases where the Span panel really shines. If you like data, the Span panel can monitor and control up to 32 circuits in your home. Turn on an exhaust fan in your guest bathroom, and you'll see that energy usage in real time via the smartphone app. Learn just how much energy every little thing in your house uses, and you might be surprised at some of the real energy hogs. It's also the perfect companion for your home battery like a Tesla Powerwall. Typically, your electrician will install a secondary critical loads panel, which excludes big appliances like ACs and car chargers. But with Span, there's no need. You set what circuits you want backed up through software. Maybe you have a huge solar system and a big battery, and you do want to run your air conditioning when the power is out. Span's newest product is the Drive Car Charger that ties into your Span panel and your entire house, and can dynamically change the speed that the car is charging based on solar generation and what appliances are on. Turn on the AC and the car charging goes down, allowing you to better utilize your solar production. Come see why Span is one of my favorite companies in the home energy space and why I'm installing a Span panel and Drive Charger on my home. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Span and you for supporting the show. Second, according to some estimates, there are about 2 billion internal combustion engines in operation today, most of which are in cars, but also in motorcycles, airplanes, helicopters, and ships. Replacing all of these implies making equal numbers of battery packs to power electric motors, putting a huge strain on the industry's supply chain that could take years to overcome. Furthermore, once we replace them, we have to do something about the old cars. The logical solution is to recycle them. Sure. But only about 80% of the car's weight is recyclable, and the other 20% goes to waste. So we're still looking at an amount of waste equivalent to the weight of approximately 400 million cars worldwide, with the average weight of a car at around 4,000 pounds. This works out to be about 800 million US tons. That's the equivalent of almost 140 pyramids of Giza. Plus, from an environmental perspective, it might be easier or better to keep the cars that have already been manufactured in operation than replacing them with new manufacturing and new cars just to change the powertrain. It'll be a challenge, to say the least. But what if we didn't have to? What if there was another way around the problem, and instead of looking for ways to replace the internal combustion engine, we found a way to save it, and with all the massive infrastructure already in place to make, service, and refuel our conventional cars, motorcycles, planes, and ships? That's precisely what several companies are attempting to do. How? By turning our carbon emissions back into fuel. Enter e-fuels. E-fuels, also called synthetic fuels, are basically any form of carbon-neutral fuel produced from carbon dioxide or monoxide and water with the aid of electricity. It's a very simple idea that works sort of like running a combustion reaction in reverse. In other words, the process takes the products of combustion, which are carbon dioxide and water, and combines them to form the original reactants, which are fuel and oxygen. Now, logically, since burning fuels releases energy, putting them back together requires introducing new energy. And for the whole thing to make sense, we need to ensure that the energy is clean. This is similar to how hydrogen is only as clean as the energy used to produce it. So why is this so important for the average Joe? Why should you even care? Well, there are several reasons. First, unlike burning fossil fuels, which takes new carbon from the ground and adds it to the atmosphere, burning e-fuels releases carbon into the atmosphere that was already in the atmosphere to begin with, making it a carbon-neutral fuel. Second, regardless of how they're made, e-fuels have a nearly identical chemical composition to the fuels we refine from crude oil. What that means is that we can use them on the same engines that run on fossil fuels today without modification. This last bit is what sets e-fuels apart from all other technologies like hydrogens, which require new fuel cells, and everything else. E-fuels are the only alternative in the world that can literally replace fossil fuels, as in take their place one-to-one. Wherever fossil fuels can be used today, e-fuels could be used tomorrow. We can carry on using vintage Harleys or huge diesel pickup trucks, and even carry on launching rockets into space and beyond, all without a single ounce of guilt. Shoot, the world could even get rid of EVs. Well, not really, but we'll get back to that in a little bit. So how does this actually work? The key process for making fossil fuels was invented back in 1952.
That's not right.
1925, and is called the Fischer-Tropsch process. This is a sequence of reactions that take carbon dioxide or monoxide and combine it with hydrogen to produce methanol, itself a fuel. The methanol is then transformed through chemical reactions into liquid hydrocarbons like the ones found in gasoline. There are also other newer processes that are based on the same principle, but that use different feedstock and milder conditions. But if this process has been around for 100 years, you may be wondering how far along is it today and why isn't it already in use everywhere? Furthermore, who is making e-fuels? Well, there are several key players in the e-fuels industry at the moment. The first one is a Chilean startup called Highly Innovative Fuels, or HIF, which received an investment of $75 million from Porsche, as well as more from Siemens Energy and ExxonMobil to build their Haru Oni plant in southern Chile, where there are some of the best conditions for wind power in the world. The plant will use wind power, generate green hydrogen, and then combine it with CO2 from the air following the Fischer-Tropsch process to produce e-fuels like e-gasoline and e-jet fuel, aka sustainable aviation fuel. The pilot plant will produce about 34 million gallons of e-fuels in 2022 and is set to reach 130 million gallons per year by 2026. This may seem like a lot, but it's really not. The US alone consumes almost three times the 2026 target annual production in a single day. But that's not the real issue. The bigger problem is that the pilot plant will produce e-fuels at a cost of about $23 per gallon at first, and they hope to bring that down to about $7.60 per gallon when they enter full-scale operation. Considering that today's diesel costs $5 per gallon, and that's high because of the war in Ukraine, you can see e-fuels have a big disadvantage in terms of cost. Air Company is another startup launched in 2019 that is currently developing a catalog of products derived from CO2 in the air, including e-jet fuel, perfumes, and even a perfectly drinkable vodka. Interesting. Although backed by huge names like Porsche and Siemens, HIF can't compete with what another company called Prometheus Fuels is doing in California. This unicorn startup promises to solve one of e-fuel's biggest problems, which is cost. The company was founded by Rob McGinnis, a Yale graduate that also made important contributions to water desalination throughout his career. Prometheus Fuels process is different from what the guys at Porsche, HIF, and Air Company are doing. Their technology, which works in modular shipping containers called fuel forges, captures CO2 from the air by dissolving it into water and then electrolyzing the solution directly to reduce that CO2 into alcohols in a process they call reverse combustion instead of using the Fischer-Tropsch process. They can do this without separating the CO2 from the water and without using an external source of hydrogen, saving a ton of energy in the process. Then they transform these alcohols into hydrocarbons to make whatever particular fuel they want. But to do this, they have to separate the water from the alcohol first. This is normally done through distillation, which is a very energy-intensive process. Instead, McGinnis and his team created a special membrane that is made up of an impermeable polymeric matrix traversed by hydrocarbon nanotubes that only let the alcohols through. You can imagine the membranes as a sheet of waterproof spandex with a bunch of straws poking out the other side, only millions of times smaller. By reducing the energy consumption in both processes, Prometheus is able to bring down costs dramatically to a point where their fuels are actually cost competitive with traditional fossil fuels, and even at the pilot plant scale. Pretty amazing. That being said, Prometheus is still not at full scale production, but it will be soon, thanks to its $1.5 billion they raised in a Series B funding round last year. So we'll definitely be keeping an eye out for them. Everything seems pretty solid, and the company CEO even claims they already have a contract with American Airlines to buy the first batch of 100 million gallons of e-jet fuel at 1 cent below the typical market price. But of course, this isn't the silver bullet to solve the energy issues, and it does have its caveats. The first one, which we've already discussed, is cost. Most processes like the one HIF and Porsche are using are just too expensive to compete with fossil fuels without government subsidies. But Prometheus may have already fixed that. But the second most important drawback is that the whole process relies on renewable energy. This creates a problem when you consider that we don't even have enough renewable energy generation to cover the worldwide demand today. Advocates for e-fuels will say that the key is to set up factories in places with a large surplus of renewable energy generation and to use e-fuels as a practical, easily transportable form of energy storage. That's why HIF set up shop in southern Chile, Africa, Australia, and in the US Sunbelt. This could make a lot of sense and easily turn into a reliable source of revenue for the lucky countries that get a lot of sunshine, wind, or geothermal energy. In fact, it may be the only practical way to literally ship sunlight and wind energy from one place to another without having to lay thousands of miles of cables to send power instead. Where have I heard about that? This video, you can check out right here. Heck, we could even use e-fuels to indirectly distribute nuclear energy worldwide. We made a recent video that got a lot of attention about how Japan has coupled their nuclear HTTDR reactor to a red hydrogen manufacturing plant. So perhaps we could do the same with Prometheus's fuel forges. The final big issue with e-fuels is efficiency. There are many steps involved in the process of turning wind or solar energy into e-fuels, and then burning those e-fuels to extract their energy. Each one of these processes reduces the overall conversion efficiency of e-fuels as an energy storage medium. According to estimates from the Internal Council of Clean Transportation, their efficiency could be as low as 16%. So you're losing 84% of all the energy you put into it making the fuel. This is mostly due to the fact that internal combustion engines have an average efficiency of just 20 to 35%. So we can't get more than that no matter how good our synthetic process is. In comparison, electric vehicles are between 85 and 90% efficient, almost 3 times better than internal combustion engine cars. And no matter what you do with the fuels, can't overcome that final part. That said, remember that there is still a niche where batteries and electric motors simply won't do the trick, like in airlines and fighter jets, for example. Also, even if it isn't as efficient as we'd like it to be, it's going to take years for us to replace the global ICE vehicle market with EVs. So if we can use e-fuels to stop adding more carbon into the atmosphere with our ICE-powered vehicles while we progressively replace them, I say it's a total win-win. If not a definitive solution, this could at least be the perfect bridge between what we have today and what we want to have tomorrow. But I'm dying to know what you think. What it comes down to is that this is a really difficult challenge and there is no easy solution. Yes, electric motors, electric cars are super efficient, but you have to mine all the batteries and you have to build the packs big enough and no one's building them fast enough at this point. Fuels are nice because you can ship a car with no fuel on board, just an empty tank, and provide the fuel like we do today. But of course, gasoline is not going to last forever and we need a replacement. There's hydrogen that has its own problems with efficiency. This is why we cover these videos, because the reality is if we want to go from where we are today to the next evolution as a society, we have to have these conversations. And I honestly do think that e-fuels could make sense, because it's really hard to imagine. We just went to Japan, and that flight, about 5,000 miles, how would you make that without gasoline today? It's hard to think about. And I think we all want to keep doing the things that we love, like driving our cars, going on travel, flying across the Atlantic or the Pacific. To do that, we have to start thinking about some of these problems and hopefully invest in a wide network of different solutions. That way, you never know which one might come out on top. Maybe e-fuels really are the future, and they become so great and 5-minute fill-ups are such a thing that they take over. It's hard to know today. But if we have deep investment in all avenues, we're going to come out on top. All right, I'm Rick with Dude Da Vinci. That is our video this week. Leave us your comments. I'd love to hear from you. And until next week, check out this video. I think you're going to like as well.